and thanks, Paul, for inviting me to give a brief introduction. I was actually going to make it, well, not really a joke, but comment on the number of people in the audience. You know, I went to school in Germany at the University of Munich, and in the Germanistische Seminar, so all of the German lectures, we had lecture halls that were bigger than this one, with even more people. But you know, this today actually reminds me very much of my times as a student. So thanks for bringing back good memories. And this should be the transition to the talk tonight, and that's memory. Because when I asked Ruth, what are you going to talk about? She said, "Well, remember one thing: the title of my talk, and that is literature in the service of memory." So now that we have that out of the way. This morning when I sat down and I was wondering, so how do you introduce a person like Ruth Klüger? You know, everyone, or almost everyone in this audience, I'm sure, Googled the name, went to Wikipedia, which you should never do, by the way, but you did anyway. But so, since you did, I'm sure you know all of the corner dates, you know, when she was born, what she did. A few things I still want to point out, and this is what I experienced. I think that's the only way that you can approach Ruth Klüger, her work, her life, and that is by, you know, by personal experience. She talks about her personal experience. I'm going to torture you a little bit with my personal experience. So I met Ruth, and she may not remember that, in 2001 at a conference, the Modern Language Association, and I had just started my graduate studies in the doctoral program at the University of Texas. And I was introduced to Ruth by one of my professors, and she said, you know, so Ruth, this is Sebastian, Sebastian, this is Ruth. And I said, Ruth, would you sign your book? And so she got that look on her face, and I knew that I had made a terrible mistake. But she signed it anyway, and she said, you know, so here it is, because you want to read it, even though you know the German version. And I thought that was a very interesting signature, you know, a very interesting dedication to that book. And so I thought about it some more, and over the years, when I read her things, when I encountered her through the various events and through the film that we watched earlier today, I was trying to figure out what my connection to her was. And I thought I admired her, but not because she survived the Holocaust or because she wrote really good books. It was because she was very honest. And so I did a little exercise this morning, and that was I sat down and I tried to come up with adjectives that describe Ruth for me, and I want to read those to you. So certainly confrontational, but I also thought feisty, not pathetic, and not sentimental. And that, you know, we talked, and I said, Ruth, again, how should I introduce you? And she said, you can say anything that you want, just no sentimental stuff. So no sentimental stuff in my introduction tonight. Honest, open, brash. She's accomplished, an accomplished literary scholar. I mean, these are all of the things that I think describe her, and that's what she means to me. She has certainly had an impact on many people who deal with the Holocaust, for lack of a better phrase here, you know, who read books, who have research, who watch films, good ones and bad ones. But I think that pretty much sums it up. You know, she's a person that does not want to please. So she will say what's on her mind, and I think this is very good. The world needs more people like her, and I don't say that just because she's right here, but I think this is pretty much what she means to me. The world needs more people like Ruth Klüger, and it's because she does what she does, and she says what she thinks. And with these words, I would like to thank Ruth for coming, for following that invitation. Thanks, Ruth, for coming to Oregon State and you know, talking about the literature in the service of memory.
Introduction. Of course, I'm pleased to see so many of you here. What I want to talk about, as you've heard, is literature in the service of memory. I want to talk about the way in which we write, read, and watch books and films that deal with the Hitler period in Europe, and specifically the Holocaust. But first, and by way of providing a background to my arguments, let me talk a bit about how I grew up as a reader in the period of the Holocaust and after. Why and how the written word mattered to someone like me, who reached the age of awareness when the Jewish catastrophe took place. I was 6.5 years old when the Germans invaded Vienna in March 1938, or seen differently and more accurately, when the German Nazis joined the Austrian Nazis and bloodlessly took over. You can choose either narrative, both are correct. It was an invasion of a sovereign country, Hitler's first. But a lot of Austrians liked being invaded. I had just learned to read, and from one day to another, I became politically aware, that is, aware of the hostile environment in which I had to live. For the next few years, until my mother and I were deported to a series of concentration camps, I had little else to do but read. Soon I could not attend school anymore, and my friends disappeared, emigrated, or were deported. If I went out on the street, I had to wear the yellow star. My father was gone, and my mother and I had to move a lot, from one crowded apartment to an even more crowded one. And there was nothing to do but read. We first lived with relatives, later with strangers, in apartments set aside for the Jews who had to leave their own homes. The adults were perennially nervous how would they not be when they suddenly found that they were outcasts, and they had no patience with children. One way of coping with the unpleasantness of the Judenstern and all that stigmatization by neighbors, old and young, one way of coping with it was to recite poems out loud, even on the street, a kind of magic spell or private amusement that turned, in my case, into a kind of addiction. I was scolded for it by my family members because it caught attention to us, and Jews, I was assured, must by all means avoid being noticeable. I couldn't understand that. Surely they, that is the Nazis, were calling attention to us, not we ourselves. And what was so bad about reciting classical ballads out loud, the perfectly respectable kind of poems that older children were made to memorize in school? I was told it makes a bad impression. Jewish children who misbehave in public call wishes, which is a Yiddish or Hebrew word for anti-Semitism, one of the few Yiddish words that were used in my family. In retrospect, I can see how some middle-class emancipated Austrian Jewish Austrians or Austrian Jews had been brainwashed by their rulers. Even then, it seemed to me correctly that the grown-ups had lost their bearing, whereas I, who had been born in 1931, thought it was ludicrous that the great storm raging around us could be increased or diminished by my good or bad manners. So I went on memorizing and reciting 18th and 19th century verse about knights and dragons and ancient bards and heroes. I could read as much as I liked because with a book I wasn't a nuisance. Sometimes the grown-ups saw my addiction to books as a sign of intelligence. Sometimes it's just a bad habit. Once I got hold of a Bible and started to read the story of Ruth, my own first name, I just got into the part where my namesake uncovers the feet of Boaz, who is a brother-in-law, yes. She uncovers the feet of Boaz, and I turned to my great uncle, the one who read the Agada at Seder service and was the only religious Jew in the family, to ask him how to interpret that strange scene. Instead of explaining, he took the book away from me. It was a holy book, not for entertainment, he scolded. I tried to assure him that I had all due respect for its holiness, and only wanted to learn about my name, humbly and reverentially. If I had been a boy, he would have reacted differently, I was sure. Boys had to study for their bar mitzvah, and it was to their credit if they voluntarily read the Bible. But girls only read books to pass the time, a trivial pursuit. The incident was typical for how I fared with my reading. I deliberately tried to avoid forbidden books, or those that might be forbidden, because I hated to give up something I'd started reading. And since it was mostly modern novels that were considered unsuitable, I came to the conclusion that colorful, attractive covers were for adults, and the monochrome volumes of German classics were for children. The classics could easily be gotten. They stood on the bookshelves of every middle-class household, especially Jewish ones, sometimes behind glass in cases with keys. But one could ask for them because they were considered good for you, like cod liver oil. They were mostly poems and dramas, 100 years old or older, pretty difficult, but I had nothing else to do and got the hang of their language with much patience and guessing. It was an odd kind of autodidactic training in syntax and logic, but it was a fair substitute for the regular schooling I wasn't getting. So literature, writing, was a good thing. But at the same time, I found out that it could also be obscene and evil. The kind of obscenity I had to deal with wasn't of the sexual kind, it was Nazi publications. They were hard to get a hold of, certainly no Jewish household would have them, but they were also paradoxically hard to avoid. They were everywhere. For example, there was the political pornography of the Stürmer, a propaganda rag that featured lecherous Jews and their unspeakable sins and crimes. That paper didn't merely enjoy a large circulation, but full pages of it were on exhibit on street corners in special cages behind wire netting so that no one could steal this precious prose. The educated classes of non-Jews professed to despise the Stürmer, but there's no denying that it flourished. I was powerfully attracted to its exuberant slime, wondering from week to week what the next outrage would be. For example, our simple Jewish burial customs were interpreted as a sign of Jewish greed and contempt for family relations. The photographed faces of men who had committed the abhorrent crime of miscegenation looked like my uncle's faces, only a little more frightened. And I tried in vain to recreate the point of view that would have detected evil in their homely, trustworthy features. Literature, the written word, script, scripture, as I came to know it, consisted thus of opposites. And I continued to think of it that way. The high-minded type was the one that I lived by, struggled to find, to memorize, even to produce by composing poems. The other was out to kill me, as I at first vaguely surmised, and later found out to be true. Its ultimate expression, I think, was the tattooed Auschwitz number, the most obscene kind of writing that ever was, and which we, its victims, those of us who survived, managed to turn into its opposite, a kind of ineradicable memorial. But I'll return to this strange paradox shortly. When I arrived at the Camp Theresienstadt, which was called a ghetto at the time and is now quite correctly considered a concentration camp, it was much harder to find something to read than it had been in Vienna. There were few books, and accordingly, they were highly valued, treated with care, and passed from hand to hand. Regular instruction for the children of Theresienstadt was illegal. But as the place was brimful of the men and women of the Jewish intelligentsia of Europe, we could occasionally sit at their feet and listen to them discuss culture with a capital C. I remember an art historian who had a volume with reproductions of famous paintings which he showed and explained to us one evening. It was just one evening, but for the first time I learned something about art and have some unforgettable memories of that book and those pictures. And I visited an old lady in the overcrowded room where she lived who tried to teach me how to read poems correctly. And sometimes a mother of one of the girls in the children's quarter, which was my home in Theresienstadt, would sit at the communal table in our room and instruct her daughter in ancient Greek history. I sat down next to her without asking permission, and she let me pick up a few hors d'oeuvres of Western civilization, fragments of school learning. All of this was voluntary and unorganized. When one of the men in German uniform appeared, we had to stop immediately, and whatever bits of printed paper we had been studying had to disappear. It was hardly a way to learn something for passing an exam, but it made learning seem exciting. In addition, I was still incessantly composing poems which dealt with the prospect of getting out of this prison, seeing the real world. Especially Eretz Israel, which didn't exist as a state to be sure, but which we talked and read about. Most of the older youth who were our supervisors were Zionists. In the spring of 1944, we were deported to what was arguably the worst place human beings ever built, Auschwitz-Birkenau. Quite appropriately, there were absolutely no books to be had there. I had a head full of poems I knew by heart, and I kept reciting them aloud in a half voice or silently. They were stabilizing lifesavers in a place that seemed to have fallen off the edge of the earth, the antechamber of death. But I don't want to describe Auschwitz to you. You have heard, seen descriptions of it. I want to talk about writing. It was there that I first came upon another kind of obscenity, as I understand it, the satirical kind. And it was in the form of proverbs, harmless sayings. The context turned them around into their opposite. The most famous of them is, of course, Arbeit macht frei, labor liberates, the sign at the entrance to the camp Auschwitz. The second most famous one is probably the one decorating the camp Buchenwald. Jedem das seine, to each his own. But there were many others written in large letters on the cross beams of our barracks. I used to stare in cold desperation at nonsense like speech is silver, silence is gold, and in utter disbelief at live and let live, leben und leben lassen. I looked at these pearls of wisdom every day, revolted by their claims to the pearls of wisdom and guides to a good life, as proverbs are supposed to be. Given the reality of the place where they were inscribed, they stood exposed as absolute lies. Since then, I cannot hear any of these German proverbs without feeling nauseated because I see their cynical application in the death factory of an extermination camp. However, as I said just before, the ultimate of obscene writing, as I see it, was the tattooed ID number on the left arm. Mine was A3537. The A was an abbreviation for a higher number, meaning that some other victim now dead had been 3537 without the A. Hence, the A was a stenographic sign for many previous killings. Our skins made it unnecessary for the Nazis to produce dog tags for us. I had been a proud reader of the written word, and instead I was now turned into material on which someone else could write and read what was written, a surface for black ink. Through the spontaneous help of another woman prisoner whom I didn't know at all, I succeeded in lying about my age, adding 3 years to my actual age of 12, and thus managed to join a group of grown women who were sent to a forced labor camp, Christianstadt, part of the larger camp Groß Rosen in Lower Silesia, where I survived. In late fall of 1944, my mother, who worked in the local munitions factory, I worked somewhere else, she asked a civilian employee who pitied her and wanted to help her in some way, if he would bring her a book for her daughter, who loved to read. She told me that the request surprised him, but he promised to procure something. I had no hopes. I thought he'll forget, or if he remembers, it'll be something like the stupid romances which the female Nazi guards read, and which occasionally circulated among the prisoners brought in by the Jewish women who had the coveted job of serving as cleaning women. During the summer, I had read two of those romances, and it had been months since I had seen a printed page. My mother's co-worker kept his promise. The very next evening, she came back with a book, looking a little disappointed and apologetic, since she said it wasn't much of anything. And indeed, it was just an old and torn school book, a reader of sorts, without a cover and with some missing pages. It consisted of texts fit for high school students. I was on cloud nine. The gift surpassed my expectations. A well-known door had opened again. Of the individual texts, I remember only one. It was a part of Goethe's Faust, very well known in German, but unknown to me at the time, that dealt with the ice of winter and the thawing of the ice and the joy of the town population who can leave their narrow houses and walk in the sun. I suddenly realized what an impact truly great poetry can have on one's life. At that time, I was half crazy with hunger, eating potato peels, which we roasted with stone wood and didn't eat raw only because they can cause diarrhea. There was no end to the cold. At night, when I'd just gotten a little warmed up on my bed of straw, I had to get up and stand in rows of five and go to work. And here was this poem, which equates cold and imprisonment and speaks of the resurrection. It's an Easter poem. Of ordinary people, not in religious terms, but in the terms of the rotation of the seasons, how they come out of, how the people come out of the imprisonment that winter imposes on them by keeping them at home. And they come out simply to enjoy the sunshine. To this day, I can viscerally feel the relationship of freedom and warmth because I understood it so well when I read about it in a great piece of poetry in the torn school book in the winter of 1944, waiting for the liberating Russian army. I come back now to the other side of the equation, deadly writing, obscene writing. That is what the tattooed numbers were. We, as human beings, had become the material on which to write what amounted to our death warrants. Our bodies reduced their writing surface, the message death. And yet, as I've mentioned, a strange thing happened. Those of us who survived these numbers formed a kind of community, and most of us did not have it removed. First of all, it was evidence of what we had experienced. And most of us felt that we were called upon to bear witness. We would have the number to prove the experience. It was an item that could be used as food for hope. That seems paradoxical, and it is. But you have to consider that hope is future-oriented. Hope says, now I'm afraid. Later I'll be able to talk about it. And I'll be able to roll up my sleeve and show the world. See, that's what they did. At the time, to me as a child, the number was something entirely novel and amazing and didn't so much terrorize as astonish me. Is it astonishing? Later in life, the number became a kind of memorial in deference to my father, and particularly my brother, who was murdered in Riga at the age of 17. Throughout the years, I felt he should have had the time I had, my time, as if I was living a kind of stolen life, living his years as well as my own. And then came a time, as I was getting older, when I turned to him as if he was a ghost shadowing me, and I said to him, you would be 70 now. You would have reached the biblical age. And if you were alive and you were walking side by side, you could only look back on your life in whatever way you would have lived it as I do. At most enjoy the limited span that's left, but no future to look forward to, just like me. To be sure, you did not have the years, and I did have them. And so you, the ghost in my mind, resented me and resented my advantage of sunshine and freedom. But by this time, you wouldn't have them anymore. You too would have to add it all up and decide if it had been worthwhile. And so it came about that I felt that I was no longer indebted to him and to the others I had left behind in Birkenau and in Gross Rosen. that I didn't owe them the number anymore. I felt that for half a century I'd carried it around, slept it on my left arm, and suddenly I lost patience. It had often caused embarrassment and even resentment of those who saw it as a provocation, though I had never regarded it as such. And I had it removed in a laser clinic in California by an efficient woman dermatologist who turned out to be the daughter of a German Jewish child who was saved through the so-called kinder transport to England. I told the ghost of my brother, you already noticed I talk to ghosts, that I'd written a book about my childhood in Nazi Europe, and that I'd lovingly mentioned him in that book, that the book was the precondition for giving up the number, the condition for an arm that would no longer be smudged by what I consider a symbol of evil. I felt I had said what I could, had been a witness, and for years thereafter, I had worn it in respect for the dead. Wore it like a piece of black clothing, a script on my arm in memoriam. And now it became again what it had been in the beginning, that is the opposite of Holy Script. Holy Script is the word of God, chiseled in stone like the Ten Commandments, or a letter in the Book of Life. The Auschwitz number was the word of death, punctured into the skin of the condemned. Well, writing that book, my memoir, bearing witness, hadn't been all that easy. Right after the war, there was wholesale denial, side by side with the discovery of what the Nazis had done. To be sure, the discovery of the genocide helped establish the state of Israel, but basically the public wanted to be left alone when it came to details. There were a lot of reports, some true, some lies. There was a cottage industry of Holocaust pornography, but essentially here and in Europe, the world was future-oriented and the survivors were regarded with suspicion. What had they done to stay alive? Had they sacrificed others? There was literature that warned of them as if they were escaped criminals. And the surviving children were sometimes seen as if they were mistreated puppies to be pitted, but too corrupted by their experiences in the camp, perhaps beyond redemption, to be admitted into a decent household in polite society. Moreover, remember, the term Holocaust for the Jewish catastrophe only came into use in the 70s. Elie Wiesel claims he first used it in this sense and brought it into circulation. Because language is so important to our way of thinking, without a verbal definition, the genocide of the Jews didn't stand out from all the other misery which Hitler and his Germany had inflicted on the world. And since it wasn't identified as a special problem, the Allies did not make it a special subject in the re-education of the German people. There was no attempt to remember or teach the history of European and German Jews, neither the history of their achievements nor of their persecution, and certainly no attempt to analyze the phenomenon of anti-Semitism. And let's face it, there wasn't much talk about it at American colleges and universities either. The first literarily great book about Auschwitz was Primo Levi's Is That a Man? Called in English, help me. Thank you. And it went back in for a publisher. It was first called Is This a Man? That's really the proper title of this extra homo thing that's in the. But it did find a small firm that issued it, and then the publisher promptly went bankrupt and took years before a respectable edition appeared. Later, of course, Levy became an international spokesman for the survivors, and his book is now universally acknowledged as a classic. There was one exception to this initial indifference. That exception was the fame that came with the international translations of an unassuming Dutch book by a child, Anne Frank's diary. But the diary is not a real Holocaust book, since it sadly ends with the deportation of the Franks. It is therefore easier to assimilate, to digest, as it were. Its tragic end is known to the reader, but it isn't part of the book. Unfortunately, it is also easier to sentimentalize the little girl than the eminently rational Italian chemist that was Primo Levi. Sebastian has mentioned my dislike of sentimentality. What it does, of course, is it victimizes and it infantilizes its object. Anne Frank and Primo Levi. Another interesting example of a Jewish child in the literature about the camps was the East German best-selling novel Naked Among Wolves by Bruno Apitz, book that appeared in 1958 and became a popular film in 1963. This is East German, the German Democratic Republic. It is set in the concentration camp Buchenwald. It deals with the heroic communist prisoners who hide a Jewish boy, a very small Jewish boy, and thus make his survival possible. The active adults whom the reader and the viewer are led to admire are political prisoners who at the end of the war liberate the camp from the inside and on their own, which of course they didn't do. Eisenhower and his army liberated Buchenwald. Apitz and his book and film aren't interested in the real Jews of Buchenwald. The teenage Elie Wiesel was one of those Jewish prisoners, but that was reality. Whereas in the celebrated book and film, the heroic communist prisoners saved a little Jew who would otherwise be exterminated. The real political prisoners privileged their own and preferred to have Jews on the lists of the transports. But my main point is that in this book and film, Naked Among Wolves, the fate of the Jews is infantilized. Jews are reduced to a passive child. The actual condition of the Jews in that camp was much harsher than that of non-Jews. At a glance at any of the photos of the emaciated prisoners at the liberation of Buchenwald will show. The point is that literature can both enlighten and obfuscate. It can be a revelation or it can lie. It can give us visions or illusions. Literature poses problems that are worth taking seriously. As we come together on Holocaust Remembrance Day to perpetuate memory, we are aware that unrecorded, unremembered events are no more than random happenings. They become history only as they enter our minds. The facts that make up reality are not history, and only acquire the claim to be the truth when we interpret them. We understand the present time only as we continue to think about the past, in other words, when we begin and continue to remember. Memory is perhaps the most unique and most valuable of human characteristics. You might say animals too have the capacity to remember. They do, but surely only the human mind knows how to reflect on what it recalls, reflect on it, and shape the future accordingly. So I proceed from the assumption that literature, and by extension film, is one of several ways which we have to understand our experience and to bring order into our memories. Recorded and interpreted works of history are the most obvious food for our collective memory, and this works of scholarship. But the past gets written up in various ways, among them fiction. And so I would like to talk about the Holocaust aesthetics, that is, Holocaust aesthetics is a deliberate provocation. For you might you not ask what can be aesthetic about the Holocaust? Isn't this an oxymoron? More than any other literary content, the Holocaust as subject overwhelms the pleasure that we expect of the aesthetic experience. And that is the question I want to raise, is the basic problem we face when we speak about Holocaust literature or when we produce it. Let me illustrate the dilemma for my own experience. Not long ago, I was signing copies of my memoir that I've been talking about, my memoir of my childhood in Nazi Europe, including a 12-year-old's unlikely escape of the gas chambers of Birkenau. A young woman came up to me with a copy of the book to have it signed. As I did so, she said with a winning smile, "I love the Holocaust." As you can imagine, my jaw dropped. Of course, she did not mean that she loved the event. What she meant to say was that she loved to read books about the Holocaust. But her naive and undisguised pleasure brought up the question, should she love to read about the Holocaust? Isn't art, even tragic art, meant to make us feel good? And should we in any shape or form feel positive and empowered, or even cathartically purged when we contemplate the extinction of the people? You remember, catharsis is the emotion of the purging of the emotion that we recognize as, since Aristotle, as the pleasure we get from tragedy. My impulse was to say this to this woman, you shouldn't stop reading these books, including mine, if you enjoy them. And I also remember the student in a Holocaust literature course I once taught who had the honesty to admit that he was troubled by the fact that he enjoyed reading the violent scenes in Jerzy Kosinski's The Painted Bird. This novel is a very graphic one, and the next time I taught this course, I did not put it on the reading list, even though I still liked it, for I didn't want to risk evoking a sadistic pleasure in my students. And this would not have been a consideration for me in any other class than one on Holocaust literature. On the other hand, in the direct opposition to my reaction to the woman who loved the Holocaust and to the student who enjoyed the depiction of inflicted suffering, in direct opposition to this is the view of a colleague in my academic department. He was in the Hitler Youth as a child, and as a young man he was in the Wehrmacht. And he admits that in those days he was a convinced Nazi. I met him many years later, and for a long time now he has been a friend with whom I mostly am in agreement on many issues. He says the Nazi period was only an episode in German history, 12 years of 1200. Of course, to you, he adds condescendingly, it was more. But that's a matter of perspective, implying that his is the better perspective because it includes more years. And to him I want to say, no, let's not forget. Let's remember with all the means at our disposal, including literature, which is his and my field, for it is the crime and the great calamity that counts, not the time that it took to commit it. It's no excuse for a murderer to say, I've lived for 40 years and it only took me half a day to kill my family and my neighbors. The rest of the time I was innocent. Isn't the Holocaust a central event in Germany's history, regardless how long Hitler was in power? So we argue, and I'm uncomfortable because of my inconsistency between these two viewpoints. Let us call it the Adorno problem, or maybe you want to call it Adorno's couple. Theodor Adorno, philosopher, musicologist, sociologist, the founder of critical theory, famously proclaimed that to write poems after Auschwitz was barbaric. Interestingly enough, he had just read one of the most impressive lyrical works about the Holocaust, Celan's poem, Todesfuge, Fugue of Death. He modified this pronouncement later so that it might read, let's not have any poems about rather than after Auschwitz. That's still pretty authoritarian, but not quite as bad as it sounds at first. For it comes in a context about the dialectical relationship of enlightenment and barbarism, and how the former, that is enlightenment, can paradoxically morph into the latter. That is, how the enlightenment, which has dominated Western thinking since the 18th century, or already since the 17th, could turn against itself in the 20th, feed on its own flesh, as it were, a pseudoscience, like racism or social Darwinism. But the reason why Adorno's sentence about barbarity and poetry after Auschwitz has produced a lot of controversy and commentary and is still worth discussing today is precisely the conundrum that I have illustrated with my account of my young American reader and my old German colleague. It is a question that is not easy to answer and leaves us with a squeamish feeling, no matter how we answer it, That is the question whether imaginative literature is an appropriate vehicle for the recollection of mass murder. Adorno didn't say that Celan's Fugue of Death was a poor poem, or even a second-rate poem. Perhaps he was even bowled over by his own aesthetic response, like most sensitive readers of Celan's work, and presumably he mistrusted these emotions. Should one react positively to what is grown on such soil? And so he threw in the towel and declared that his enjoyment was barbaric. Yet the question remains valid, and the dilemma is real and must be seriously weighed. But let us assume that literature is indeed one possible means of interpreting experience. More than that, of coping with experience. If that is so, who is to say that some experience is proper for such interpretation, while other kinds are best left to the archivists only? From a personal standpoint, I might ask, and that's why I've told you so much about memorizing poetry, I might ask, why do you wish to ghettoize in a literary way my childhood experience, but consider everyone else's, including your own, fit subject for poetry? Why may poetry interpret war, death, sickness, sex, any number of unappetizing psychological states, but not the camps? I do not blame God in paradise, telling us that we may eat everything that the garden provides, except this fruit from this tree, which tellingly is called the tree of knowledge, knowledge of good and evil, which in our case is knowledge of the camps. But you might argue on the other side, isn't the literary treatment of genocide a kind of escapism? Now poetry, and by extension prose literature as well, has always been a means of escape from misery and from seemingly unbearable grief, a way to transcend material hardship through mental effort. Many former inmates of the camps, myself included, as you've heard, will agree that it functioned in this way. And if I was right during the war, how could it have become wrong after the war? Well, the answer might be because in the one case, it was an aid to survival. In the other case, it may be cheap escapism. My counter-argument to this is it always depends on what you escape from and where your means of escape lead you. If you escape from a prison into freedom, but it's actual physical freedom or freedom of thought, escape is not only justified, it's desirable. That is what art does. It goes to give us a kind of freedom of movement, a place where thought and emotion meet, and the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune are left behind, and at the same time better understood. The other kind, what we usually mean and what we disparage when we call it escapism, provides us with easy solutions and with voyeuristic sensations. These sensations include the sadistic and the sentimental, and the Holocaust lends itself to exploitation of both. The art of literature advances the truth. Its flip side is a bunch of lies. One is poetry, the other is kitsch. We as readers and critics have to decide which is which. When we refuse or hesitate to apply the critical standards which we use for other literary works to the artistic or literary memorialization of the Holocaust, the discussion can get mired and recriminatory, and we don't get anywhere. Another eminent Jewish writer has weighed in on the question, is Elie Wiesel, who maintained at one time, I don't know if he still does, that no novels can or should be written about Auschwitz. He recommends that only historians and survivors are in a position to do justice to the great Jewish catastrophe. But scholars too often use aesthetic means to convey their intentions, and those intentions are often as selective as those of novelists. As for survivors' memoirs, some choose to write about their experiences in fictional form, in the third person. Examples of these are the late Jorge Semprún from Spain, or the Nobel Prize winner Imre Kertész from Hungary, or the Austrian Fred Wagner. And among women writers, there's the incomparable Cordelia Edwardson, a German, who died in Stockholm a few months ago, unfortunately, who wrote in Swedish. In her autobiography, she switches from first person to second and then to third person, a novelistic effect that she uses to extraordinary aesthetic advantage. I learned from her how worse certainly an aesthetic device can have a place in such memoirs. These are literary elements used to enhance the historical impact of the survivor's factual account. Should we question the validity of these books because of their methods of presentation? We don't. Well, we feel they are not deceptive, as in the notorious case of Bruno Dösecker, alias Benjamin Wilkomirski, a Swiss non-Jew who invented a Holocaust childhood out of whole cloth and caused a justifiable furor when the fraud was discovered. When his book was first published, it was greeted with words that were more appropriate to fiction than to history. For instance, from the New York Times, a reviewer gushing, quote, Wilkomirski records the Holocaust with a powerful immediacy of innocence, injecting well-documented events with fresh terror and poignancy. Constructed like flashes of memory, his book unfolds in bursts of association the way children tell stories. He writes with a poet's vision, a child's state of grace, end of quote. Wilkomirski's German publishers was warned early on that there was something fishy about this autobiography. They stopped the presses and sent a scout to Israel to consult historians and psychiatrists, people who, however, can only have guessed whether these memoirs were plausible, not if they were true. Then they asked the author to write a postscript and went ahead with the production of the book. Yet in this postscript, Wilkomirski virtually warned the readers that they're not necessarily reading a fact-based book, though he didn't call it a fiction either. He wrote, legally accredited truth is one thing, the truth of a life is another. It sounds even more convoluted in German. Die juristisch beglaubigte Wahrheit ist eine Sache, die eines Lebens eine andere. This is a fancy way of saying, never mind the facts that can be verified, it's what in my head that matters. And who cares about the relation between the two? When fictional and historical categories become inextricably entangled, does it matter which is which? Of course it does. After Wilkomirski's work turned out to be a fraud, some critics tried to salvage it as a work of fiction. They argued if it was good writing and we thought it was a memoir, then must be good fiction now we know it's invented. But the opposite is true. Once the book was seen as historically false, it became at the same time literary kitsch. What had seemed to be a child's sincere outcry now seemed a manipulative imitation of suffering, exactly as it would in real life, if we hear someone crying and we rush out to help him and it turns out that he has fooled us. Equally vexing to me is the book of one of the most highly regarded Auschwitz survivors, the Polish non-Jew Tadeusz Borowski. His story is about the camp originally entitled The World of Stone, and now they're called Survivor in Auschwitz, I think. It's composed as fiction with structured plots, individual characters, and direct dialogue. Those are the hallmarks of fiction. It is widely admired, and I've often quoted it and belonged to its, I'm one of its admirers, because of the starkness with which Borowski portrays the slide from indifference to depravity at the edge of human existence and endurance. At the same time, many of the most outrageous bits in that book may be invented and are in fact not presented as recorded history. My problem is that they're about Jews and arguably, I think, anti-Semitic. For they show Jewish prisoners as the most corrupted of all prisoners. There is one scene where a Jew describes with relish what a treat it is to eat uncooked human brain, uncooked human brain. The idea that a Jew, even a hungry Jew, would enjoy cannibalism is such a cynical parody of kashrut laws, the laws that govern the Jewish diet, that I would put it on the same level as Jews eating matzahs baked with the blood of Christian children for Passover. Most unconvincing to me, and yet perhaps most famous, is a scene of arrival in Birkenau, where a Jewish mother of a small girl simply abandons her before any selection has taken place, leaves her crying on the ramp where they've just arrived in the cattle wagon, and vainly attempts to save her own life, the mother attempts to save her own life, by simply going in the other direction. The child is askew to Shirley Temple in this description. The scene strikes me as implausible, and certainly not as typical or paradigmatic, if you prefer, as fiction should be. I say this as a woman who was a 12-year-old myself at that time, on that ramp, and I lived for the rest of the war among older female prisoners. We accept these scenes in Borofsky's book. We accept them unquestioningly as illustrations of human depravity at the outer edges of existence. Because of that, and not because they're based on fact, which they aren't. They are in a fictional framework. But because the author, Tadeusz Borowski, was indeed a prisoner in Auschwitz, albeit a non-Jewish prisoner, and not an inmate of Birkenau, the death camp, but of the so-called Stammlager Auschwitz I. I'm revolted by such scenes, and at the same time I admit that they're gripping and have depth. The book has become a classic of Polish literature. But I think that what I consider as anti-Semitic aspects should at least be a subject of discussion and not be swept under the rug. This leads to the consideration, to the question whether books and films with the Holocaust as a background are more restricted and not the main event than other fictional accounts that lean heavily on other kinds of historical background. The Shoah is such a major perversion of civilization in our own time that any misplacement of the facts strike me as an intolerable violation. I'm sure I'll strike many of you as a purist when I say that I dislike Benigni's acclaimed film La Vita Bella, Life is Beautiful, because of the implication that parents could protect their small children in the camps. It's the other side of the coin from Borofsky's Jewish mother who abandons her child first chance she gets. Benigni plays on our desire to see the depiction of human goodness in improbable circumstances. Borofsky on an all too easy acceptance of human corruption. Neither enhances our insight into human strength and weakness. Probability matters. I often stop reading a book where I recognize a willful or negligent misuse of the Holocaust background. The facts, whether they play a major or a minor role, even when they are just used as a sort of decoration, as a significant reference in another context, should be checked. They shouldn't be falsified for convenience sake or as a short symbol for horror. For example, don't put women into men's camps only because the names of the latter are better known, or put gas chambers into camps where they were known, or mix up gas chambers and crematoria. All meddling with the evidence denotes contempt vis-à-vis the very horror of which the author professes his or her humanitarian concern. It means that the author was too lazy to look up the evidence so that he values his emotions higher than you, the reader's claim to fathom what went on in the camps. So where does that leave us? Since we have internalized the Holocaust as the ultimate evil, what is imaginable and endurable, since we can't get away from it, we have to ask, how do we deal with it? How do we imagine it? We know that works of the imagination have a place in our consciousness. How close does fiction have to stay to the documents? How far does the historian impose his views and speculations, not to mention his authorial digression? And that poses the further question, what does fiction owe to the facts? And on the other hand, what may factual accounts, to what an extent may factual accounts avail themselves of fictional devices and what are the limits that writers, both of fact and fiction, should observe? Oddly, precisely these questions have been hotly discussed during the past weeks in the case of that extraordinary film, Lincoln. As you know, Lincoln film has been immensely admired, but also criticized for allegedly twisting the historical record, for transposing certain events, and for omitting the role that blacks played in their own emancipation. And that may be the reason the film lost out at the Oscars to Argo, another historical but far less controversial entertainment. Both Spielberg, the director of Lincoln, and Kushner, the author of the screenplay, are of course Jews, and both are acutely aware of the Holocaust. I need not remind you of Schindler's List, Spielberg. And Kushner easily slips into mention of the Holocaust when he talks on TV. My point is that when these apparently non-aesthetic questions are asked directly, the so-called aesthetic experience begins to lose its independence. It frays at the edges and merges and overlaps with other experiences, political ones, historical ones. And that is the exciting challenge for future authors and critics. They will have to judge both the historic view and how a given work interprets and perhaps transcends and expands the event aesthetically. And they will have to argue their case not only on the basis of a given work, but also on principle, for setting standards, instead of simply justifying a scene here and taking a stab at another one there. They will have to ask, where do we come from, the historical question, and where are we going, the moral and aesthetic one. Those are the questions that poetry asks. They will have to establish criteria, and writing about the Holocaust may well serve as a touchstone of how to judge imaginative literature as such. For the same questions ultimately relate to all imaginative works, and the Shoah is merely the outer edge, as far out as you can go. The questions are not new, they have been asked in various contexts by literary critics and historians, but they have never been asked with the emotional intensity which the Holocaust imposes on us, and, though perhaps to a less extent, on those who come after us. We can't expect a lasting interest in mere information, but it's true that at present memory still haunts us because the fabric of society has been torn in our own time, or in the time of our parents and grandparents. But in the long run, memory becomes blurred, the weights shift, different events become foreground, others move to the back burner. The favorite mantra of our present memorial cult, let us remember so the same thing doesn't happen again, is unconvincing. To be sure, the remembered massacre may serve as a deterrent, but it may also serve as a model for the next massacre. We've seen this happen more than once since the end of World War II. That's the bad news. The good news is that memory as written persists. St. Brun, a Buchenwald survivor who wrote 5 books about the camps, explains the paradox of writing then, and always going back to this experience. He explains it thus, everything about the camps, he says, can be expressed in words. That is, he rejects their alleged unspeakableness. But to write down these words, he says, is an unending task, because you never stop remembering. Memory never reaches a goalpost where it can rest, because by being narrated, it becomes intensified. Today, we often hear the anxious question of what will remain when the last living witnesses have died. At the age of 81, I count myself among the youngest ones who remember Auschwitz. My answer is, what remains will be, as it always has been, the written word with the history of invented stories, interpreted and absorbed by its readers. Put slightly differently, that which is inscripted, scripture, if you will, not holy scripture, but the word received and filtered by the human mind. Thank you.